Good morning everyone. Today I am going to present development of occlusion. That includes the introduction, characteristic of human dentition, various stages of occlusion, predentate jaw relation, deciduous dentition period, mixed dentition period, permanent dentition period, conclusion and references. Introduction, the term occlusion that derived from the Latin word that is occlusio. According to the angle, occlusion is the normal relation of the occlusal planes of the teeth when jaws are closed. According to the Bishra, occlusion it is the way in which the maxillary and mandibular teeth articulate. And according to the American Association of Orthodontists, occlusion is the relationship of the maxillary and mandibular teeth as they are brought into the functional contact. Now, evaluatory changes from the reptilian dentition that were polyphodont, that includes the many sets of the teeth that evolved to the diphodont in mammals. As the dentition evolved from the homodont, that includes the all the same teeth in same size and shape, to the evolved to the heterodont in the present day humans. Now, characteristic of human dentition, depending upon the mode of attachment, acrodont is characterized by the attachment of the teeth into the jaw by a connective tissue. Thicodont, that are the teeth in which the teeth are inserted into the bony socket. And pleurodont, the in which the teeth are inside the jaws. Number of successive teeth. Polyphodont, in which the teeth, multiple sets of teeth are there. And the teeth replaced throughout the life, for example, in shark or crocodile. Diphodont, in which the two sets of the teeth are present, like in human being, and monophodont, in which the single set of teeth are present, like for example in sheep or goat. Now, shape of the teeth in homodont, all the teeth are same in form, function, and shape, and in heterodont, the teeth are different in size, shape, and form and functions. Dental formulas in humans. In deciduous dentition, dental formula is with two incisors, one canine, and two molars. And in permanent dentition formula, it consists of two incisors, one canine, two premolars, and three molars. Now, various stages of occlusal development. That includes the predentate jaw relationship, deciduous dentition period, mixed dentition period, and permanent dentition period. In predentate jaw relationship, it starts soon after the birth and lasts till the 6 month. And during this period, the neonate has no teeth. The amount, the mouth of the neonate, that consists of gum pads. At the time of birth, the alveolar processes are covered by the gum pads that from the thickened by the periosteum, which is pink in color and firm in consistency. The pads get divided into the labio or lingual portion by the dental. Here, the upper gum pad, it is the horseshoe-shaped pad, and these are the transverse grooves that divide the gum pad into the 10 segments. In the gingival, this is the gingival groove that divides the gum pads from the palate. This is the dental groove that starts from the incisive papilla, extend towards the canine region, and ended in the molar region. And this is the lateral sulcus that is present between that divide the anterior and posterior segment in the region of canine and molar region, between the canine and molar. Lower gum pad, that is U-shaped and in rectangular shape. It also consists of dental groove, gingival groove, and lateral sulcus. Relationship of the gum pads. In neonate, there is a complete overjet, which diminishes markedly during the first 6 months of the age. Then anterior open bite. At rest, the upper and lower gum pad contact in the posterior molar region. and this is called as infantile open bite, which is considered to be normal and helpful during the suckling process. In the intermaxillary space, closure occurs with the eruption of the primary teeth, thus it is self-correcting anomalies of the developing occlusion. Now in class 2 pattern, with the maxillary gum pad being more prominent than the mandibular gum pad, then mandibular functional movement, they are mainly in the vertical direction, then little extent at the anteroposterior direction. Then mandibular lateral sulci, that is posterior to the maxillary lateral sulci, which is helpful in the predilecting the interarch relationship at the very early stage of occlusion. Cleaning of the gum pad, that is started within the first week of the birth, and for that we have to take a small gauze between the thumb and forefinger, then wipe over the gum pad. The basis from the arches is determined in the intrauterine life. According to the Langton, the size of the gum pads at the birth might be determined by the following factors. That includes the state of maturity of the infant at birth, the size at the birth as expressed by the birth weight, the size of the developing primary teeth, and purely genetic factors. Now, neonatal jaw relationship. At birth, both maxilla and mandible are small compared to the rest of the face. Here we can see newborn's pseudo appearance of the micrograntia. Development of the both jaws extensively in the transverse and ventral direction, that leads to the anteroposterior relation between the jaws. The correct maxillomandibular relationship developing after the birth is probably achieved by the physiological sucking exercise. There is a variability in the relationship of the upper and lower gum pads at the birth. So the neonatal jaw relationship cannot be used as a diagnostic criteria for a reliable prediction of the occlusion in the primary dentition. Simpson and Chung found that only 2% of all neonates have anterior open bite gum pad relationship. They also reported that oral habits had a definite influence on the infantile gum pads, resulting in a significant increase in the anterior open bite incidence by the age of 4 months. Now, precociously erupted primary teeth, sometimes child born with the already present teeth in the mouth. So, teeth that are present at the mouth at the birth are called as the natal teeth. Neonatal teeth that are erupted during the first month of the life, pre-erupted teeth that are erupted during the second and third month of the life. The teeth that are most common are mandibular central incisor to erupt, which are usually display the enamel hyperplasia. The most commonly occurs in the mandibular region of the central incisor, that is followed by maxillary incisors, then mandibular cuspids or molars, and maxillary cuspids or molars. Natal or neonatal cuspids are extremely rare. Now, incidence of the natal or neonatal teeth. Bodenhoff, Ajaya et al. Reported that 85% of the natal or neonatal teeth are mandibular incisor, and 11% of teeth are maxillary incisor. 3% are mandibular cuspids and 1% are maxillary cuspids or molars. Oshima et al. Emphasized that multiple natal or neonatal teeth are extremely rare. Predilection for natal or neonatal teeth for females is more. Kate et al. In 1984 reported that 66% of the female against the 31% of males. They also reported the incidence of natal and neonatal teeth to be estimated in the range of 1:1000 and 1:30,000. Palalusua et al. In 2002 reported the prevalence of the neonatal and natal teeth is 1:1000, and Khatib et al. In 2005 reported the prevalence of neonatal and natal teeth is 1:3400. One article that incidence of the natal teeth in the newborns in the Government Medical College and Hospital, Chengalpattu, a pilot study, by Vidya Albert et al., Journal of Clinical Diagnostic Research, in 2017. They resulted that among the 4,300 children, only the four neonates were born with the natal teeth. And their studies showed that the female predilection and most commonly erupted teeth were mandibular anteriors. They also showed that the delivery of the type of delivery had no significant relation with the presence or absence of the natal teeth. Now, classification of the natal or neonatal teeth. In 1997, Hebling classified the natal teeth into the four clinical categories that includes the shell-shaped crown that are poorly fixed to the alveolus by the gingival tissue and absence of a root. In second category, solid crown that is poorly fixed to the alveolus by the gingival tissue and little or no root. In third category, they included the eruption of the incisal margin of the crown through the gingival tissue. And in fourth category, they included the edema of the gingival tissue with an unerupted but palpable tooth.
Now, starting with the etiology, it can be due to the superficial position of the tooth germ, infection or a malnutrition, eruption accelerated by febrile incidence or a hormonal stimulation, or any hereditary transmission of a dominant autosomal gene, or osteoblastic activity inside the germ area related to the remodeling phenomenon and the hypovitaminosis. Now, one article, size, ultrastructure, microhardness of natal teeth with the agenesis of the permanent successor. And the result shows that only remnant of the enamel were present. All crown dimensions were within the normal range. The ultrastructure of the hard dental tissue was normal. The radicular dentine hardness of the natal teeth was similar to that of the normal primary mandibular incisor. So, they concluded that natal teeth were prematurely erupted regular primary mandibular central incisor. In their case, the occurrence of the natal teeth associated with the agenesis of their primary successor appears to be related to an accelerated or a premature pattern of the dental development rather than to superficial positioning of the tooth germ. Now, the syndrome that are associated with the natal teeth, that is chondroectodermal dysplasia or Ellis-1 Krivelled syndrome, which is an inherited disorder which involves the bones of like skull and the cranium and associated with the very short stature of the person, which is also known as dwarfism. And people with this condition also have a short legs also and the forearm. Then the second one is the oculomandibular dyscephaly with the hypotrichosis or the Hollerman strip syndrome. In this condition, the abnormalities of the skull and certain bones or a face are there, and also it affects the eyes also, ocular defects are seen, and in this condition also short stature is present and dental abnormalities are there. Then pacunica congenita or Jadassohn-Lewandowski syndrome. And this syndrome, since birth, elephant nails are present and also curved nails are present and the thickening of the skins are also there, which is known as hyperkeratosis. Thickening of the skin seen also in the palm, sole, knees and the elbows of the person. Now the complication that is associated, which include discomfort during the suckling, laceration of the mother's breast during feeding, sublingual ulceration that is known as zygapidoid disease and the aspiration of the teeth. Now the diagnosis, how the diagnosis we can make that is from the clinical and the radiographic finding. According to Almeida CM et al. In 1997, radiographic verification should be made for the presence or the absence of a primary tooth germ that would determine whether the tooth belongs to the normal dentition or not. According to Brand SK et al. In 1983, most natal and the neonatal teeth are the primary teeth of the normal dentition and are not supernumerary teeth. According to Hawkins in 1932, it corresponds to the teeth of the normal primary dentition in 95% of the cases, while 5% cases are supernumerary. Now, one case report. In which photograph A shows a 17-day-old infant with the neonatal teeth in the mandibular anterior region. B shows the radiographic examination which shows the neonatal teeth. C shows after extraction of the neonatal mandibular anterior teeth. And D shows a patient with the almost all the deciduous teeth in the arch. Now the treatment of this include if the erupted tooth is diagnosed as a tooth of the normal dentition, then maintenance of this teeth in the mouth is the first option unless this would cause injury to the baby by Robert M. W. in 1992. If the teeth are well implanted, then this teeth should be left in the arch and the removal should be indicated only when they interfere with the feeding or when they are highly mobile, according to Toledo AO in 1996. In 1998, by Martins et al., he suggested a smoothing of the incisal margin or a placement of a round smooth composite resin over the incisal edge to prevent wounding of the maternal breast during the breastfeeding. If the treatment option is extraction, then avoid unnecessary injury to the gingiva. According to Rao R.S. et al. In 2009, prophylactic administration of the vitamin K 0.5 to 1 microgram IM is advocated because there is a risk of the hemorrhage as the conventional flora of the intestine might not have been established until the child is 10 days old. And since vitamin K is essential for the production of prothrombin in the liver. Now, starting with the regurgitated disease, which is a major complication from the natal or the neonatal teeth, is the ulceration on the ventral surface of the tongue, which is caused by the tooth sharp incisal edge. And this condition is known as regurgitated disease or the syndrome. Now, starting with the case report. Regurgitated disease in the association with the natal teeth by Sujata Parana et al. Journal of Dental Research and Review 2017. Introduction. It was first described by Antonio Riga in 1881 and subsequently it was examined by Francesco Quede in 1819. Which is a rare pediatric condition in which chronic lingual ulceration results from the repetitive trauma. The presence of the teeth at birth may lead to the development of the regurgitated disease that may appear as a traumatic ulcer, and it is commonly located on the ventral surface of the tongue or a lip and the mother's breast. The several terms that have been used in the literature, such as congenital teeth, fetal teeth, predeciduous teeth, and dentistia precox. Starting with the case report, a 16-day-old female infant accompanied by mother was referred to the Department of Pediatric and Preventive Dentistry, Bangalore, with the chief complaint of teeth in the lower front region of the jaw and the difficulty in feeding. The intraoral examination revealed the two natal teeth with the grade 2 mobility in the mandibular anterior region and the presence of the ulceration on the ventral surface of the tongue. The inspection of the ulcer revealed that a circular lesion of 4 mm diameter on the tip and the ventral surface of the tongue with the white fibrous plaque on the surface and was painful on the palpation. The case was diagnosed as a precocious regurgitated disease and they decided to extract the natal teeth due to its mobility, which may otherwise lead to complications such as swelling or the aspiration during nursing and prevent healing of the ulcerated lesion. So for extraction, parental consent was obtained and the extraction was done under the topical anesthesia followed by curettage of the extraction socket. And the extracted teeth were yellowish in yellowish white and opaque without tooth. And the ulcer was resolved and improvement in suckling was also observed at the 10-day follow-up visit. In the discussion, they mentioned that prolonged gingival irritation may increase the incidence of the gingival fibrous dysplasia. As the feeding of the child is affected during the early infancy and associated with the difficulty in feeding, the growth and the development of the child are affected as the source of the nutrition during the infancy is the mother milk only. Tang et al. Proposed that the trauma is only a contributing factor in the development of the regurgitated disease that could lead to viral and the toxic agent penetrating in the submucosa and into the traumatic area, causing inflammatory reaction and the tissue loss. Joseph B.K. in 2010 stated that ulceration of the tongue may also be due to other causes like bacterial or mycotic infection, allergies, or any immunological disease, primary syphilis and agranulocytosis, and the tumors like traumatic neuroma. Removal of the natal teeth is indicated when they are poorly developed or it can be interfere with feeding or if it is highly mobile and associated with the soft tissue growth. They concluded that the presence of natal teeth creates anxiety in the child and the parent as well as difficulty in feeding, and the early diagnosis helps in the early resolution of the ulcerative lesion and also aids in the resuming normal feeding. Now, what is self-correcting anomalies in the pre-dentate period? They are the anomalies which arise in the child's developing dentition during the period of transition from the pre-dentate period to the permanent dentition period and get corrected on their own without any dental treatment. This self-correcting anomalies include retrognathic mandible, anterior open bite, and the infantile swallow. Now the deciduous dentition period. The deciduous dentition stage starts from the eruption of the first deciduous teeth, usually the deciduous mandibulocentral incisor, and end with the first permanent molar, for example, from the 6th month to the 6th year of age. And by 2.5 years of age, deciduous dentition is usually complete and it is in full function. The root formation of the all the deciduous teeth is complete by the age of the 3 years of age. Now, the chronology for the primary dentition, according to Willer, the first evidence of the calcification of the central incisor is seen in the 13 to 16 weeks in utero, and root completed at the 1.5 years. For the lateral incisor, first evidence of calcification seen in the 16 week of utero, and the root is completed also in 1.5 years. For the canine, the first evidence of calcification seen in the 17 week utero, and root is completed in almost 3.5 years. For the first molar, the first evidence of the calcification seen in the 15.5 week in utero, and root completed in the 2.5 years. And for second molar, The first evidence of calcification seen in the 18 weeks in utero, and the root is completed almost in a 3 year. For the primary lower teeth, the first evidence of calcification seen in for the central incisor 14 weeks in utero. For lateral, it is 16 weeks. For canine, it is 17 weeks in utero. For first molar, it is 15 and half weeks in utero. And for second molar, it is 19 weeks. And root completed for the central incisor at 1.5 years. For lateral incisor, it is 2 years. For canine, and the root completed at 3.5 years. And for first molar, it is 2.5 years. And for second molar, the root completed at 3 years. Now, the status of the dentition. At the 7 months, in the child's mouth, the only the first tooth is erupt and the present. At the 11 months, the four teeth are seen that include two upper central incisor and the lower central incisor. At 15 months, 8 erupted teeth are there in the mouth that include upper central and the lateral incisor and the lower central and the lateral incisor. At 19 months of age, 12 teeth are erupted in the mouth. And for 23 months, 16 erupted teeth are there in the mouth. And at 27 months, all the 20 teeth are erupted in the mouth. The characteristics of the primary dentition include face dentition, deep bite, and the minimal overjet. Relationship of the secondary primary molar, vertical inclination of the anterior teeth, and the dental arches that normally ovoid in shape. Now, starting with the space dentition, which is also known as open dentition. The space or open dentition seen in the primary teeth, it is a primary dentition in which interdental spaces are present, which is known as open or a face dentition, which is of two types. That is physiological, which is also known as developmental and generalized, and second one is primate or a simian or the anthropoid spaces. Now, physiologic or developmental or the generalized spaces, it is termed as physiological spaces as a Delibere in 1819. It is called as developmental spaces by Faber in 1962. The reason for this space is the anterior-posterior growth of the jaws. The space dentition is preferable to avoid the crowding in the permanent dentition, and the developmental space in on average in the maxillary arch, it is average of 4 mm, and for in the mandibular arch, it is of 3 mm. Now, the simian or primate or the anthropoid spaces. It is called simian spaces by Bohm in 1940, primate spaces by Bokia in 1968, and the anthropoid spaces by Foster and the Hamilton in 1969. It is called anthropoid spaces because as it usually seen in the monkeys, it is present mesial to the maxillary primary canine and distal to the mandibular primary canine, and primate spaces are usually used for the early mesial shift. The incidence for this is 70% in the maxillary arch and 63% in the mandibular arch, and the amount of the primate space present in the maxilla is about 1.7 mm and in the mandible is about 1.5 mm. Now, starting with the closed dentition, it is referred to as a primary teeth without any spaces between them. The lack of spaces can be due to either wider primary teeth or the reduced arch length. the closed dentition invariably leads to crowding in the permanent dentition. Now, overbite, when the overlapping of the incisal edges of the upper primary incisor over the lower primary incisor is known as overbite. The average overbite in the primary dentition is about 2 mm as compared to the permanent dentition, which is about 2 to 3 mm. When the primary incisor erupts, the overbite is deep. This could be due to the vertical inclination of the primary incisor, and over the period of time, deep bite reduces due to two main reasons that include eruption of the primary molar and the rapid attrition of the incisor. Now the overjet. Overjet is more initially in the primary dentition, but with the movement of the whole dental arch anteriorly, overjet decreases, and the average overjet in the primary dentition is about 1 to 2 mm. One article on lower arch dimension in the children with the anterior open bite and normal vertical overbite, a cross-sectional study in which this cross-sectional study was performed in 132 individuals with the AOB and 132 with the normal vertical overbite between 8 and the 16 years, and intercanine width, arch length, intermolar and interpremolar distances, and the arch perimeter of the lower arch was measured previously in the previously digitalized model using GOM inspection program, and they concluded that the individual between the 8 and the 16 years of age with the NVO, that is normal vertical overbite, showed smaller lower dental arch than the individual with the anterior open bite in the most dimension. Now the terminal plane relationship. Bohm in 1950 classified
Now terminal plane relationship. In 1950, Bowman had classified the depending upon the primary molar relationship using the distal surface of the primary second molar in the three category, that is plus terminal plane, mesial step and distal step. The straight or flush terminal plane, a line drawn along with the distal surface of the maxillary second molar and mandibular second molar. If it is straight, then it is called straight or flush terminal. It is seen in 76% of cases, and it guides the permanent dentition in either class 1 or endon relationship. Then mesial step, if the line drawn along with the distal surface of mandibular second primary molar is mesial, here we can see the line drawn distal to the mandibular second molar is mesial to the upper line drawn, distal line drawn upper second molar, and it is seen in the 14% of cases, and it guides the permanent dentition in the either class 1 or class 3 relation. Now class distal step, a line drawn along with the distal surface of the mandibular second primary molar is distal to the distal line of the upper second molar, and it is seen in the 10% of the cases, and this guides the permanent dentition in the class 2 or endon relation. Now flush terminal, usually the flush terminal plane is the most favorable to guide the permanent dentition in the class 1 relation. Here the distal step in the primary dentition that lays the permanent dentition in the either class 2 or endon relation, and flush terminal that guides the permanent dentition in the endon or class 1 relation, and mesial step that guides the permanent dentition in class 1 or class 3. In a study of Bishra on 121 children at the age of 5 years, the distribution of terminal plane relationship of the primary second molar were found, that is as follows, that distal step in 10% flush terminal plane, that is with 29%, but in mesial step of 1 mm, that is the mesial to the distance that is only 1 mm, that is the case of 42%. And if it is greater than 1 mm, it is the cases that are present was 19%. And they concluded that 90% of cases at the flush terminal relationship, which was either flush or with the 1 mm or greater than mesial tap relationship. Now, canine relationship, class 1 relationship, that the cusp of the maxillary primary canine is in the same vertical plane as the distal surface of the mandibular primary canine. In class 2 canine relationship, the cusp of the maxillary primary canine is mesial to the distal surface of the mandibular primary canine. And in class 3 canine relation, the cusp of the maxillary primary canine is distal to the distal surface of the mandibular primary canine. The increased percentage of distal step, that is 33%, had been reported in the study of Kaskinen-Nistula et al. In 2003 on infant children. A study that primary canine and molar relationship in centric occlusion in the 3 to 6 year old children, a cross-sectional study given by Dilip Kumar et al., International Journal of Clinical and Pediatric Dentistry in 2019. The result of this study showed that the molar relationship 56% with the mesial step, 36% that is with flush terminal, 8% that is distal step. And in the canine relationship, 61% of the children have class 3 canine relationship, 21% of the children have class 1 canine relationship, and 12% of children have class 2 canine relationship. And thus they concluded that the mesial step primary relationship was more common among the 5 to 6 year of old children, that is followed by flush terminal and distal step relationship. The class 3 canine relationship was more common, followed by the class 1 and 2. Now, occlusal development in children of American, African descent and the types of terminal plane relationship in the primary dentition are given by Arnett et al., Comparative Study, Journal of Angle Orthodontics, 2006. They concluded that the African American and European children, a mesial step rather than a flush terminal plane is the norm of the completed primary dentition. Thank you. And rest of the part we will continue in the second session.